Thank you very much. So I should, I mean, I'm a bit sorry. My first talk today will be a bit boring because I feel some kind of responsibility for giving some definitions related to derived categories. So far, in the first two talks, we've seen some interesting geometry related to derived categories, but let me also give a brief introduction explaining what derived categories are. Okay, so let me start with an abelian category. Its derived category is defined as follows. You start with the category, say, of bounded complexes of objects in A. So I guess everyone knows what is a complex. Bounded means that it has only finite number of non-zero terms. And usually we use cohomological gradient, which means that the differential increases the gradient by one. Okay, so this category of complexes, it comes with a notion of a morphism of complexes. Of course, a morphism of complexes is a morphism of underlying graded objects in this abelian category, which commute with the differentials of the complexes. And because of that property, if you have a morphism of complexes from f dot to g dot, say phi dot, then it induces a morphism between the cohomology objects of these complexes. So first of all, for each integer I, one can define the cohomology object of the complex f dot to be the quotient of the kernel of the morphism from fi to fi plus 1 by the image of the object of the morphism from fi minus 1 to fi, just the usual definition. And then because a morphism of complexes commutes with the differentials, by definition, it induces a morphism between cohomology objects of these complexes. So this is denoted by hi of phi. Okay, so for every morphism, we have this bunch of morphisms between these cohomologies. And so the crucial definition here is the definition of a quasi-isomorphism. So a morphism of complexes phi is called a quasi-isomorphism. If hi of phi is an isomorphism for every I. So in other words, the condition is that the morphism induces an isomorphism on the cohomology objects. And the bounded derived category of an abelian category A is defined as the localization of the category of complexes with respect to the class of quasi-isomorphisms, which means that we artificially add morphisms to our category which are inverse for every quasi-isomorphism. Or saying it informally, we just don't distinguish between complexes that are quasi-isomorphic. Okay. In fact, you have to do some work to show that this definition makes sense. In fact, to define a reasonable category structure with these properties, it is not that simple, but I will not discuss this. You can look into some standard textbooks where this process is described in detail. So for instance, there is a textbook of Gelfand and Manin dealing with this subject, and there are also more modern approaches using, for instance, differential graded categories, and you can look, for instance, into the paper by Keller, where all this are also described. So let me just assume that such operation, such localization operation is well defined on the category of complexes, and there is a category in which the objects are the same as the objects of the category of complexes, and the morphisms are just, so to say, formal compositions of usual morphisms and inverse to quasi-isomorphisms. Okay. In fact, a bit later, I will describe a bit the structure of the derived category, and you will see that the definition itself is not very much important. It is much more important to understand how you can work with this category, and this I will try to explain in more details. Okay, so this is the definition, and let me also mention that by definition, there is a natural functor from the category of complexes to this localization category, so we can think about this functor as a functor from the category of complexes to the derived category, so every complex can be considered as an object here, and also we have a natural functor from the original, from the initial abelian category to the category of complexes. Given an object, we can just consider a complex which has zero terms everywhere except of degree zero, in which degree it has just this object as its term. So we have this embedding, and so usually we will consider objects of this initial abelian category also as objects of the derived category by thinking of them as of complexes with only one term in degree zero, with only one non-zero term in degree zero. Okay. So, in fact, the most important thing is the structure that we have on the derived category. And the structure is called triangulated structure. So, in fact, triangulated structure consists of two pieces of data that satisfy some properties. So the first thing that should be specified is what is called the shift functor. In topology, it is also usually called suspension functor. So this is just an automorphism from from a category to itself. So maybe let me state it as a definition of what a triangulated category is. So let me state as a definition. Triangulated category is an additive category T with, first of all, there should be an automorphism of this category called the shift functor, and its iterations are usually denoted by the corresponding integers in the bracket. So its kth power is denoted by k, and since it is an automorphism, you can also take k to be negative. So for every integer, we have the shift by k functor. So this is the first piece of data. And the second piece of data is a class of what is called distinguished triangles. Which are just sequences of morphisms that look as follows. F1 goes to F2, goes to F3, and then the next morphism goes to F1 shifted by 1. So this shift by 1 is precisely this shift automorphism, which is usually the notation for it is this bracket notation after the object to which it is applied. So to to specify a class of distinguished triangles means to specify some number of sequences of morphisms that have this form. Okay, and of course they should satisfy a number of axioms, a list of axioms. And I also don't want to list these axioms here. You can easily find them in the textbooks or even in Wikipedia or wherever you like. Let me just mention only some of them, so to say, maybe to say that they are the most important is not the right word, but those axioms or properties that are used most frequently. So the first property or axiom, in fact, is the following. Whenever you have a morphism between two objects of your category T, it can be extended to a distinguished triangle. So maybe every morphism extends to a distinguished triangle. That means that for any morphism, you can find F3 and phi2 and phi3 such that this sequence is a distinguished triangle. And the corresponding object F3 that extends this morphism to a distinguished triangle is in fact defined up to a non-canonical isomorphism, and it is usually called the cone of the morphism. So, typically you can write this distinguished triangle in this form. So this object called the cone of phi. And let me repeat again that the cone of a morphism is defined up to a non-canonical isomorphism, which means that any two extensions, for any two extensions of this morphism to a distinguished triangle, the corresponding objects are isomorphic, but there are different choices of such an isomorphism, and there is no canonical choice, which leads to some complications of the theory. But still, the isomorphism class of the object is well defined. So, so this is the first property which I would like to mention. The next property is that whenever you have a distinguished triangle, you can construct from it many other distinguished triangles. So, for instance, you can forget about its first object, and then you can write what you have, and then you can add F2 shifted by 1 on the right, and the morphism F1 shifted by 1 here. And one of the axioms says that this triangle is distinguished if and only if this triangle is distinguished. And this second triangle is usually called rotation of the original triangle rotation. And so in other words, a triangle is distinguished if and only if its rotation is distinguished. And in particular, this axiom, I mean, in fact, you can, using this procedure, you can extend your original triangle to an infinite sequence of morphisms. It will look like this. And so on, and it goes both to right and left. And such a sequence, which you can always construct starting from a distinguished triangle, is called a helix associated with this distinguished triangle. And it has a property that if you take any three any three consecutive arrows in this helix, then they form a distinguished triangle also. Okay. And one of the main properties is that if you have a helix like that one, you can apply to it the functor of morphisms from any object of your category or to any object of your category, and then you will get a long exact sequence of Hom spaces. So this is also a very important property, which is maybe most frequently used, that for any object G in T, you can just apply the functor Hom from G. You will get something like that. And so on, and this sequence is exact. Is a long exact sequence. And analogously, you can apply, instead of applying functor Hom from G, you can also apply functor Hom to G. Of course, this functor is contravariant, so you will get a sequence with arrows going in the opposite direction. So maybe let me write it like this. From F3 to G. From F1 to G, and then from F3 by minus 1 to G. So it is also a long exact sequence. Okay, and maybe let me also mention some useful exercises for those who haven't worked with triangulated categories. This will be quite useful, I think. So first of all, assume that you have a distinguished triangle in which the morphism phi 3 is 0. Then one can deduce from this that F2, the object F2 in the distinguished triangle, is in fact isomorphic to the direct sum of F1 and F3 in such a way that the morphism F1 is the embedding of the direct sum end, and the morphism F2 is the projection on the other direct sum end. So this is a useful thing to see, to check. And another one is that if the third object of the triangle is 0, then phi 1 is an isomorphism. So this is if and only if. So a morphism in a triangulated category is an isomorphism if and only if its cone is 0. So in some sense, this notion of the cone is a mixture between the notion of a kernel and of a co-kernel in an abelian category. So if you have a morphism in an abelian category such that its kernel and its co-kernel are 0, then the morphism is an isomorphism. And this is an analogous property in a triangulated category. Okay, and now let me just say that derived category has a triangulated structure. This is an important theorem, so probably due to Verdier, that dB of A has a triangulated structure. Such that the shift functor is given by the shift of grading of complexes which means that if you have a complex f dot, then if you want to shift it by one, then its term in degree I should be f I plus one, which eventually means that you shift the complex to the left. So you should keep it in mind. And also the differential of the complex changes its sign. This is by definition. So the shift functor is given by this shift of gradient of complexes. And with the cone of a morphism defined to be the mapping cone of complexes. And cone of phi from f dot to g dot being the mapping cone, which basically means the following. So if you take your morphism of complexes, so gi minus one, and if you have a morphism of complexes, then you have this diagram with commutative squares, and so you can consider this diagram as a bicomplex. So there are arrows of two directions, and if you imagine that it is not concentrated in two rows, but in infinitely many rows, just all the other rows being zero, then the composition of horizontal arrows, of two horizontal arrows will be zero, the composition of two vertical arrows will be zero, and the arrows themselves will commute. And in, so this is what is called a bicomplex. And whenever you have a bicomplex, you can consider its totalization, which is just, which just means that you sum up along the diagonals of this complex and use these arrows to put a differential on this totalization. This is what is called the cone of a morphism of complexes. And so the theorem of Verdier says that if you define a cone of a morphism in this way, and if you define the shift in this way, then all this gives you a triangulated structure. Okay. So let me say a couple of words about how one can think about objects of the derived category. So in fact, from the definition, and this is a kind of naive approach to think about objects as about complexes that has that have their terms and differentials and so on. But this is not a very good point of view, because terms are, because you can have two isomorphic objects in the derived category that have completely different terms. The term of a complex is not a notion which is invariant under a quasi-isomorphism. So it is not a good notion. But the notion that is good is the notion of the cohomology of a complex. So one should think of objects of G B of A as about cohomology objects linked to each other. And let me explain what does it mean, linked together. So to explain this, let me introduce one more notion, which is very useful, which is the notion of the canonical filtration. So assume that you have a complex fi minus 1, fi, fi plus 1, and so on. Let me define now two other complexes. So for each integer k, let me define tau less than or equal than k of f dot to be a complex which has the following terms. So the term in degree I will be equal to fi if I is less or equal than k minus 1. It will be equal to the kernel of the morphism from fk to fk plus 1 if I equals k. And it will be 0 when a is greater or equal than k plus 1. And similarly, you can define t greater or equal than k, tau greater or equal than k of f, to be the complex which has term 0 for I less or equal than k minus 1. So it should have term image from fk to fk plus 1 when a equals k, I equals k, and fi when I greater or equal than k plus 1. Then what it is very easy to see is that for any k, there is a morphism from tau less or equal than k of f to f. So it is just given by natural embeddings. And it is easy to see that everything is compatible with the natural differentials. And then there is a morphism from here to tau greater or equal than k plus 1 of f. And in fact, this gives you a distinguished triangle. So there is a distinguished triangle of this form for any k. And also, it is very easy to see that if you... Sorry. Thanks. What? Wait. No, yeah, you're right. Okay. A very important property is that if you consider the cohomology of these truncated complexes, then the cohomology is the same as the cohomology of your original complex when the index, when the degree corresponds to the degree in the notation for this truncation functor and zero otherwise. And analogously for the other truncation functor. Let me check. It depends whether we put k plus 1 or k here, so maybe... This is the crucial property that should be satisfied, and let us just see whether it holds for this definition or not. Maybe just to be on the safe side, let me write it in a bit different way. So let me first do it for this truncation complex. You can just take the quotient of your original complex, but what you see here, yeah? Then this is right, this is right. And here you should take just the quotient of fk by this kernel. And this will be precisely the image. So I think that this is correct. Okay? Sorry. This canonical truncation distinguished triangle is in some sense the main tool to think about objects of the derived category. In some sense, you can think about this object as about glued from this part and that part, and with this morphism being the gluing data. And note that these two objects are more simple than the original object that you started with, just because by this property, they have a smaller number of cohomology shapes. Yeah? And in the end, you can somehow to split any object into the bunch of its cohomology objects, and that will be linked by morphisms of that type. And let me maybe leave it as an exercise to check the following statement. So assume that we have an object that has only two cohomologies. Such that hi of f is 0 for I not equal to k or l. And assume that we fix two integers k and l, k is less than l, and I, so maybe let me write it like that. So k is less than l, and I is not equal. All the cohomology except the cohomology in degree k and l are 0. Then isomorphism classes of such objects, the isomorphism class of f is determined by, first of all, hk of f, hl of f, and a morphism, let me call it epsilon, which is a morphism from FL of HL of F to HK of F shifted by L minus K plus 1. For instance, if L equals K plus 1, if you have cohomology in two adjacent degrees, then this morphism lives in home from one cohomology to another, shifted by two. And by the way, this is a standard convention to use X notation for such home spaces. So by definition, this is just X L minus K plus 1 from one to another. So in some sense, in the same way as in an abelian category, you can construct more complicated objects by considering short exact sequences, and so by constructing them from simpler objects by using X1s to link. In the same way, in a triangulated category or in the derived category, you can construct any object from shifts of objects in your original abelian category by using higher X groups. So, and this is the way it is better to think about these objects. Okay. So what goes next? Now we discussed a bit triangulated categories. Now let me say a couple of words about triangulated functors. So if we have two triangulated categories, T1 and T2, then a functor between these categories is called a triangulated functor. If, first of all, basically it should preserve the triangulated structures of our categories, which means that it should first commute with the shift functors, if it commutes with shifts, which, to be more precise, it means that a commutativity morphism should be specified. But, I mean, in almost all the cases when people discuss triangulated functors, this commutativity morphism is left implicit, but still you should be careful a bit with it. So the first property that the functor should commute with shifts, which means that if you shift an object, then apply your functor, it is the same as you first apply the functor and then shift the object. And also, the second property that it should take distinguished triangles in the first category to distinguished triangles in the second category. Let me write it. Keeps triangles distinguished. Okay, so this is the notion of a functor, and usually we will, at least in my lectures, we will discuss derived categories of coherent shifts on some smooth and projective varieties. So we will start with some smooth and projective variety over some field. And maybe for simplicity, it is better to assume that the field is the field of complex numbers. But of course, in most cases, it doesn't matter. But let me use this assumption. Then we consider the category of coherent shifts on X. This is a nice abelian category. And then we consider its bounded derived category. And usually we will discuss its properties. And to simplify the notation, I will denote it just by D of X. I will skip this letter B, but I will consider only the bounded category. Okay, so what kind of functors do we have in geometry between derived categories of coherent shifts? Let me mention some of the most important functors. In fact, this is the a very good property of the geometry, is that it always comes with many functors. So what kind of functors do we have? So assume that we have a morphism between two algebraic varieties, X and Y. Assume that both are smooth and proper. Then in this situation, one can define the push-forward functor between the categories of coherent shifts and the pullback functor. And one can extend them to derived categories by considering derived functors. So there is derived push-forward functor from D of X to D of Y, and left derived pullback functor from D of Y to D of X. Okay, and and for instance, if you take a coherent shift, say F in Koch of X, if you apply derived push-forward functor to this object, it will no longer be a coherent shift in general. And if you compute the cohomology shifts of this object, this will be the classical derived push-forward functors. So in some sense, this total derived push-forward is a derived category version of this usual derived push-forward functors that takes that keeps not only these cohomology shifts, but also these linking morphisms between them. So to specify this functor is such a specification contains strictly more information than just specifying this sequence of classical derived push forward functors. And similar, in the same way for pullback, if you have an object in Koch of Y, then if you compute the cohomology of the derived pullback functor, then this is L minus E pullback of G. So usually for the derived pullback functors, people use homological notation, and because of that, there is this change of sign when you go from cohomological notation to homological notation here. Okay. Besides these two functors in the derived world, there is one more important functor, which is called the twisted pullback functor. In fact, coming back to this situation, a very good property of these two functors is that they form an adjoint pair. So in fact, if you compute Holmes from the pullback of now of any object of the derived category G in so let G be in D of Y and F be in D of X, then if you compute Holmes in the derived category of X from the pullback of G to F, then this is canonically isomorphic to Holmes from F to the derived push forward of from G to derived push forward of F. So there is this very useful adjunction isomorphism, and it means that the pullback functor is left adjoint to the push forward functor. But also one can construct the right adjoint functor to the push forward. So the next important functor is this twisted pullback functor, which goes from D of Y to D of X, and which is right adjoint to the push forward. So in a contrast to the previous situation, this functor is not a derived functor of some functor between abelian categories, but it is a nice triangulated functor. So this adjunction means that we have a similar isomorphism to this one. So let me also write it down. So if you compute Holmes from the push forward of F to G, this is the same as Holmes from F to F upper shriek of G. This is this isomorphism, which is frequently called the Grothendieck adjunction. And in fact, in the nice situation, if we consider this nice situation when both X and Y are smooth and proper, then one can even write down an explicit formula for this twisted pullback functor in terms of the usual pullback functor and the canonical class. So in fact, the formula is that this is the same as derived pullback of G tensored with relative canonical class and with the shift by the difference of the dimensions. So this is another important functor. Okay, so next functors that people frequently use are the tensor product and local Holm functors. So let me also mention them. So this time you don't need to consider two varieties. So just start with one variety. And again, it is better to assume that it is smooth. And then for any two coherent shifts, there is this standard tensor product functor on the category of coherent shifts. And you can extend it to what is called derived tensor product functor of x to d of x. And in the same way, probably I should write it like that. Tensor product and derived tensor product. So this is the notation for functors. And also, there is another functor. So this takes F1, F2 to F1, tensor F2, and well, derived tensor product here. But if you have two objects, two coherent shifts, you can also consider the shift of local morphisms between F1 and F2. This is also a coherent shift on X. So just to distinguish between this vector space of morphisms and this shift of I will use this calligraphic notation. And in the same way, if you have two objects of the derived category, you can define R-HOM complex of coherent shifts in D of X. And again, these two functors are related by adjunction. So if you compute HOMs from F1 derived tensor product F2 to F3, this is the same as HOM from F1 to R HOM from F2 to F3. Okay. And again, like in this property, if you apply this derived tensor product or derived R-HOM functors to coherent shifts and then compute the cohomology shifts of these objects, then you will recover tors of two coherent shifts in the first case and local X shifts in the second case. Okay, so these are the main functors. And of course, these functors satisfy a long list of relations, which is very useful to know if you want to work with derived categories of coherent shifts. Let me mention some of them. So relations. So first of all, there are functoriality relations. Basically, it means, for instance, that if you have a sequence of two maps, F and G, then if you compose derived functors, the derived push-forward functors, then this is the same as derived push-forward functor for the composition of morphisms. And the same for the pullback, and the same for the twisted pullback. So the first are these functoriality isomorphisms. Second, besides these adjunctions that were mentioned before, so we have three adjunctions on the blackboard. Besides them, there are also the local versions. In fact, everywhere we can just replace this global HOM by appropriate local HOMs. So these are called local adjunctions. So for instance, let me say what will it be in the first case. Of course, you cannot do it just naively. You cannot replace this HOM and this HOM by local R-HOM, just because this will be shifts on different varieties. So the right-hand side will live on Y, and the left-hand side will live on X. But if you apply a push-forward, then everything will be fine. So like if you apply derived push-forward to R-HOM from L, F, upper star of G to F, then this is the same as R-HOM from G to the push forward of F. So there are relations like that. And you can do the same for the other two adjunctions that you have on the blackboard. The next list of relations corresponds to the tensor structure, to the monoidal structure given by this tensor product. So this derived tensor product defines a monoidal structure. On d of x, which basically means that, in fact, it is symmetric monoidal structure, which means that tensor product is commutative, associative, and also the pullback functor is compatible with this monoidal structure. It is a monoidal functor. On the other hand, if you consider the push forward, it is not compatible with the monoidal structure. It is not true that if you take the tensor product of two objects and then push it forward, it will not be equal to the tensor product of the push forwards. But instead, there is another important relation, which is called the projection formula. And which says that if you take the push forward not of arbitrary tensor product of objects upstairs, but if you take one arbitrary object and if you tensor it with the pullback of another object, so if you consider push forward of a tensor product like that, then what you will get will be just the tensor product of the push forward of the first object with the second object. So this is also a very important relation. Okay, and maybe let me finally mention the base change. So what's that? Assume that you have a morphism and a fiber product. Assume that you have this fiber product diagram, this Cartesian diagram. So this is Vx and this is F sub t. Then you can always construct a natural morphism between the composition. I mean, the goal of the base change formula is to relate the composition of the push forward with the pullback and of the pullback with the push forward. And what you can easily do, you can easily construct a natural morphism from the composition of the pullback and the push forward to the composition of the push forward and the pullback. So there is always a natural morphism like that. And so you can ask in which cases this morphism is an isomorphism. And in fact, you can say very explicitly that it is an isomorphism if the diagram is what is called tor independent. And it means basically that if you take any two points on x and t that have the same image in S, then if you take the local rings of these points on x and on t and consider the tensor product over the local ring of the corresponding point on S, then this tensor product should not have higher tors. So tors greater than zero from over O S sub S of O X sub X and O T sub T is zero for any pair of points x and t such that f of x equals s equals v of t. So if this condition is satisfied, then there is this base change isomorphism. And of course, this condition is satisfied when one of these two morphisms is flat, just because in this case, the corresponding ring is flat over the other ring, so its tensor product, its torus with any other module are zero. But there are also other cases when this is correct. For instance, if both morphisms F and V are closed embeddings, and if these subvarieties intersect transversely in S, then also this is a tor-independent condition. So for instance, if X, S, and T are all smooth varieties, and the fiber product has expected dimension, then the diagram is tor-independent. And this is a very useful thing in many cases. Okay, I see that my short introduction become a bit long. Yeah, so probably I will not be able to do anything besides it. So maybe let me introduce one last notion, which is also a very important one, and give several more exercises. And then we will turn to some interesting stuff tomorrow. So one more notion is a more general notion of a functor that is used in most cases. So this is what is called Fourier-Mukai functors. So assume that X and Y are again smooth projective varieties, then and assume that we are given an object, some object in the derived category of their product in D of X times Y. Then we can define a functor associated with this object, which is called a Fourier-Mukai functor. Associated with K, or sometimes one can say with kernel K, is a functor which takes the following form. So the usual notation is phi sub k from d of x to d of y. And the definition is the following. You should write the corresponding diagram. So we have two projections, p and q. Yeah. And then this functor is a composition of the derived pullback. Then you can tensor it with k in the derived sense, and then you push it forward also in the derived sense. So you pull back, tensor product, and push forward. So this is a more general functor than just pullback, push forward, or tensor product. This is like a general combination of these three functors that we have seen before. And to finish, let me just write some exercises about Fourier-Mukai functors, which are also quite useful. First of all, assume that you have a morphism. Then we can consider its graph. So let gamma f be the embedding from x to x times y, the graph of f. Then one can show, so this is the exercise is to show that the push forward functor is in fact the Fourier-Mukai functor with the kernel being the structure sheaf of the graph. And similarly, if you want to express the pullback functor as a Fourier-Mukai functor, you can also do it. Let me just write it in this way. So the derived pullback functor is also a Fourier-Mukai functor. Also, if you want to express the tensor product functor, then it is also easy to do. So let me denote by delta the diagonal embedding of X into its square. Then if you want to consider the derived tensor product functor with some object E in D of X, then it is the same as Fourier-Mukai functor with kernel being the push forward of E. And also show that a composition of Fourier-Mukai functors is also a Fourier-Mukai functor. And is that all? Yeah, and also adjoints of Fourier-Mukai functors are also Fourier-Mukai. So if you take the left or the right adjoint of a Fourier-Mukai functor, then it is also a Fourier-Mukai. And in these two cases, it is better if you will be able to write the formula, write the kernels. So in the first case for the composition, and in the second case for the adjoint functors. OK, let me stop here. And I hope next time it will be more interesting.